He was at a news conference at the Drake Hotel here in Chicago in 1951, where a professor and vice president of the University of Illinois announced that they have a new drug that would cure cancer. Of course, this created quite a buzz that there was a drug that could cure cancer. The drug was named Crebiazin. It was a drug that had been invented by someone who came over from Europe. University of Illinois got involved in backing that, lending their name and credibility. The only problem with Crebiazin is that it was all a lie. There was no power in Crebiazin to cure, even to treat any kinds of cancer. The Food and Drug Administration did a study and decided that it was sugar pill, that there was no active ingredient in Crebiazin at all. The professor was removed from the University of Illinois. He was removed from being a vice president of the university, and it stands as a scandal. It stands as a black eye in science. The reason why this was such a big deal, thousands marched at the U.S. Capitol when the FDA held hearings and said this stuff is fake, because it had raised so highly the desire for hope. We have within us a desire to be transformed, to not feel like we're victims of this hard, cold, cruel world. And in that, we are no different than those people who received this letter to the Colossians. If you have your copy of the Scriptures, take a look at Colossians. It's in the New Testament, chapter 2. In that little backwater city of Colossae, the city is so small that archaeologists have still not found any viable buildings left over. Backwater town, but in that small town, a church had taken hold, had taken root, and had begun to grow. And in that church, people began to grow in their faith, understanding the power of Jesus Christ to transform. And false teachers had come in. They were beginning to trip up the faith of these young men and women. They were saying things like this: we know the secret. We have truth. Follow our rules and you will have power in this life. Now, in that day, what they worried about was wind, weather, and the planets and the stars that they thought represented gods. And angels, and demons. And these false teachers said, hey, we're all for Jesus Christ, but if you'll learn our secrets, if you'll follow our rules, we will show you the power to have power or authority over all those things in life of which you are afraid. You and I are the same today. Oh, we don't believe that there are gods or demons behind the stars or the sun and the moon. We don't believe in witch doctors. We don't believe in people that can give us some sort of magical charms to heal our sicknesses. But you and I can put amazing amount of trust in things like science. You and I can believe that true heart transition, true heart change can be found in political power or in our financial resources or in the truth of science or technology. Or maybe it's the power, political power, to change the world, and we put our hope there, and we're sold this bill of goods. There is a secret truth, and if you will follow our agenda, you'll find power. And Colossians is written as a response to that. It stands for all time for the truth that is found in Jesus Christ. In fact, let me just give you the theme of Colossians. It's found in verses 6 and 7, the second chapter, verses 6 and 7. And it's this: Jesus Christ is the truth and the power that transforms. You want to know what is the truth about the transformation of the human heart? It's this: Jesus Christ is God in a body, who lived, died, and rose again on behalf of the sins of the world. And when I believe that, I am transformed. Jesus Christ is the power to transform. Through my faith in him, believing the truth of Jesus Christ, God works in my life tremendous transformation. I am not the same person I used to be. I do not have to live in fear of this world. What the false teachers in Colossae held out is hope for truth and power. The Apostle Paul, writing on the inspiration of the Spirit of God, clarifies for us that Jesus Christ is the truth and he is the power to transform. Look at Colossians chapter 2, verse 6 and 7, the theme verses for the entire letter. Therefore, as you receive Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. Now, six times in this paragraph, the same turn of phrase is used. It's a prepositional phrase, in him. In other words, you want to know about truth, the truth that brings power to transform the human heart, it's found in him. You want to understand how God transforms us, understand it happens in him. So remember chapter 2, verse 6, that's our memory verse. It's the theme of the entire book. Why don't we try reciting that together? Oh, you're a little nervous about that. All right, how about if we project it for you? And we're going to say the reference, and then we're going to say the verse. Will you join this with me in this? Colossians 2, 6. Therefore, as you receive Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him. There it is. The truth, the power for transformation comes in the person of Jesus Christ. And when he says, so walk in him, the concept is, as you began in Christ, the expectation is you will walk, you will make progress in Christ. You will grow in that. And so two things, really, the entire context of this two paragraphs revolves around two things. One is truth, and the other is power. In other words, if I'm going to be transformed, if my heart and my soul are going to be changed, if it's going to overflow into my family or my work, this church or my community, I've got to know the truth, and I've got to experience the power. The problem with Kerbiazin is that it was a lie, and it had no power. Transformation comes when I know the truth and experience the power that comes in Jesus Christ. So, Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 through 10, deal with truth. Now, hear what I'm going to read. It's all going to grow out of being in him, in him, in him. That is the truth about human transformation is found in him. The power to change the soul of a human being is found in him. So, Colossians 2, let's pick it up, verse 8. See to it that no one takes you captive. Hold on a minute, what's that about? Well, that's a warning. The false teachers are saying, follow our secrets. Follow our rules. There's some truth we know that the rest of the world doesn't know. There's some things you ought to do that will lead to transformation that others don't know about. In fact, this is the fourth. There are four warnings. Look at chapter 2, verse 4. So that no one may delude or deceive you. Austin talked about that last week when he preached. Then you get to chapter 2 and you get to verse 8. See when no one takes you captive. That if someone wants to cart you off as a kidnap victim by giving you deceptive truth, look at verse 16. Therefore, let no one pass judgment on you. And then look at verse 18. Let no one bench you or disqualify, let no one get you out of the game of transformation. There really is truth, there really is falsehood. We've got to discern between the two. And the power to transform is found in the truth about Jesus. So here's what he says, verse 8. See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ. There are those who have, according to this world, a certain way of seeing things, and there are those who are in Christ who see things differently. Understand where the truth is. Look at verse 9. Here's the truth. And again, look at what it begins with, that prepositional phrase, for in him. You want to know about truth. You want to experience power. It's found in him. In him, the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily. All that you and I know or can experience about God is known and experienced in Him. There are no secrets out there. Jesus Christ, not a secret. We need to trumpet that from the rooftops. God, from eternity past in existence, condescended, humbled Himself, became human. Don't think of a superhero, half human, half God. That's false doctrine. 100% fully human. All that you and I experience, Jesus Christ experiences. And fully God, 100%. How can you be 200%? I don't know. It's the truth. It's the mystery of the incarnation. 100% God, 100% human. All the fullness of deity dwells in Him or in His body. The fully human, fully God. Look at verse 10. And you have been filled, what's the prepositional phrase? In Him. You've been filled in Him who is the head of all rule and authority. Okay, if we're going to experience life transformation, it's got to begin with truth. Here's the truth. Jesus Christ is God in a body, and He alone holds the power to transform the human heart. Now, see if I can use an illustration we understand. You need some fundamental things. If we're going to be good at football, right? And who thinks the Bears are good at football this year, right? They're bad. The Bears are bad. What do we need to be good at football? Somebody help me out. Quarterback. Well, you're a believer, huh? All right. In Trubisky we trust. What else do we need? Offense, defense. Yeah, come on. You're a Bears fan. You got to say defense, right? And offense this year. I mean, you know, I'm 48 points? Who saw that one coming? What else do you need? Receivers, right? That would help, I think. Anything else? You guys are good. One thing we're missing. Give it to me here. A football. I mean, whatever else you're going to do when it comes to playing football, you got to have the football. It's the fundamental truth of football. Listen, Jesus Christ, fundamentally, you want to have life transformation, you got to have Jesus Christ. Now, Josh, can you play soccer, right? Can you catch this if I throw it to you? If I make a good throw? Why don't you stand up? I don't want to hit your mom with her new glasses. Are you ready? All right, here we go. Oh, that was a terrible throw. Mandy, what? Right. Hey, Josh, let me see. I feel embarrassed in front of all these people here, so I'll throw it left-handed. That's probably better. So who said quarterback? Yeah, stay away from me, right? How's this? Is that better? All right, good. So you want to know about the truth. The truth of football is you got to have football. And the truth of transformation is Jesus Christ as God who created us has the power to transform us. Now, second. There's not just truth, but there's power. And what happens next as we go through verses 11 through 15 is six things God does in transforming us. In other words, if I trust Jesus Christ, if that's the truth of transformation, and I believe Jesus Christ, God, who died, buried, rose again, and that begins that process of transformation, what might I expect the changes to look like in my life? And so look at verse 11. Now we're not just talking about truth, we're talking about power. Remember, you want to be transformed, you need truth, and you need to have power. So look at verse 11. In Him, there it is again. There's that little prepositional phrase. The power in transformation is in Him, that is in Jesus Christ. In Him, you also, well, verse 10 says, you've been filled in Him. All right, whatever we have in God, we have in Christ. Verse 11, in Him you also were circumcised with a circumcision made without hands by putting off of the body of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, having been buried with Him in baptism, in which you were also raised with Him through faith in the powerful working of God who raised Him from the dead. And right away you're like, okay, all right, what's going on? I don't get it. Well, all right, not only are we filled in Him, we are transformed in Him. And to illustrate that, Paul uses two symbols that were very familiar to the people who received this letter. For us, it needs a little explanation. Both baptism and circumcision speak of being welcomed into a covenant community, welcomed into the family. For the Old Testament Jew, the symbol of circumcision is with a young boy, there would be this little operation, and that was a mark or a symbol of welcome into the family of the covenant family of God. the point of circumcision was simply this. God promised that through one child, one day, he would send a Savior. And the symbol of having children, of course, related to circumcision. And when God sent Jesus Christ as the fulfillment of that promise, the need for circumcision fell away. You don't have to have that symbol anymore. We have the reality in Christ. Then he talks about the illustration of baptism. Baptism, he says, is an example of how you were buried and you were raised with him. So if you've been to a baptism service at our church, you get the symbolism. Buried in the likeness of his death. As Christ died and was buried, so our old self is put to death. Raised up out of the water as Christ was raised to new life. So that symbolizes our new life. The symbols are, in this example, circumcision, welcome to the Jewish family, or baptism, welcome to the Christian family. But the symbols represent the reality. Now listen. The power of transformation is not found in the symbol. The power of transformation is found in what that symbol represents. All right, let's read the rest of verse 12. In which you also were raised with him, I have this underlined, through faith. The power of him who raised Jesus Christ from the dead. In other words, it's not the symbol of circumcision, it's not the symbol of baptism that has the power to transform. It's faith in God that brings the power to transform. So listen. As wonderful ethnically as circumcision can be, a symbol of God's covenant in the Old Testament, as wonderful and as important as baptism is as a symbol of my faith in Jesus Christ, as important as communion or my confirmation or my Sunday school or church attendance, all of those things, important as they are, they're simply secondary to the truth that what brings transformation is my faith in Jesus Christ. You were raised not by baptism. You were raised spiritually from the dead, not by circumcision. You were raised through your faith in the powerful working of God who raised Jesus from the dead. Look at verse 13. Not only does Christ fill us, all that we know about God, all that we have in God, we have in Christ. Not only does he transform us, once we were dead, now we're alive. Once we were far away, now we're brought near. Welcome to the family of God. But he also gives us new life. Look at verse 13. And you, it's very pointed, you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, and again, it's very emphatic, it's an implied, you, God made alive together with him. You who were dead is the very same one God has now made alive. We are given new life. You who were dead in their trespasses, the uncircumcision of your flesh, you, God made alive together with him. Listen, the end of verse 13 gives us the fifth thing. He forgives us, having forgiven us all of our trespasses. How do you do that? Verse 14, by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. He set aside, nailing it to the cross. You have been given new life, and you've been forgiven. When he talks about nailing that writ or that document to the cross, he's talking about an IOU, the debt that stood against us, that in the person of Jesus Christ bearing our sins, that IOU was satisfied in Christ. So back in February, I told you I bought an old beater car, and I bought it from a guy, and I paid for it, and I had this certificate, right? It's a title. And I had to sign it, and I sent it down to the state. And the highest authority in the state of Illinois, the Secretary of State, sent me back about 6 weeks later a title with my name inscribed on it. And on the back of the title, it's free and clear. There, it said, who do I owe? Nobody. Right? Listen. In the person of Jesus Christ, you put your faith in him. You are set free. You are forgiven. No one has anything against you or over you anymore. Hear what I'm saying. I want to be clear. Some of you say, I am an alcoholic. I'm a drug addict. I'm an adulterer. I'm addicted to pornography. I'm an angry man or an angry woman. I'm a gossip. I've failed repeatedly in marriage or relationships. I'm a prodigal. You can list all those things and identify, I'm this, I'm that, I'm the other. Now listen to what I'm saying. No, you're not. It's sub-biblical thinking. God took away what is against you. Now listen, I come from a long line of alcoholics. I understand alcoholism. And if an AA meeting helps you, God bless you, go. But you should not identify yourself primarily as an alcoholic or a drug addict or any of the other things, and more that I didn't mention also, that you're feeling right now today. Fundamentally, you were dead and you've been brought alive. You were guilty of sin and now you're freed from that guilt. Do you understand that? The single biggest thing that Christians fail to understand is the power of Jesus Christ to transform. You are not who you used to be. Stop living like that. You're not dead, you're alive. You're not in debt, you're free. You owe sin nothing. We'll still fail, we'll still struggle, but when we do, that doesn't mark who we really are. Who we really are is the person convicted for the very reason that God is saying, change from that. And that power, it's not found in a secret. It's not found in a list of rules. It's provided through relationship with a person in Him. In fact, not only are we transformed, not only are we set free, not only are we forgiven, look at verse 15. He, meaning the Father, God the Father disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in, look at that last prepositional phrase, in Jesus Christ, in Him. That means we're given victory. That means I don't live in fear. Remember I said in the ancient world what they feared was the wind and the weather and the gods and the witch doctors and the angels and the demons that controlled, they thought, their destinies and the fates. And these lying teachers in Colossae said, hey, we have the secret. If you follow our rules, we'll give you the key to unlocking all of that power. Paul said there's no secrets. There are no rules to follow. The reality of power is Jesus Christ. He's God in a body. How do you top that? Listen carefully. We live in a great day. I love our modern world. But you and I can very easily be duped, as the Colossians were in danger of being duped, into fundamentally trusting lesser things for transformation. We trust science, the politics, technology, money, education, social justice, influence in the world. Now listen to what I'm saying. Those are all powerful things. They all have their place and all should be utilized for the good of culture. But every single one of those things falls short of the truth of Jesus Christ and the power to transform the human heart. And every one of those things, listen to me, must bow before Jesus Christ. Hear what I'm saying in this riven, divisive age. First, you're a Christian. Then you're a Democrat or a Republican or a Cubs fan or a Sox fan. Somebody emailed this week and said, hey, I want to know, would a gay feel at home in your church? Do you welcome? Are you open and affirming of gays? And I responded by saying, they are welcome here. Gay or straight, adulterers or gossips, Cubs fans or Sox fans, all are welcome at our church. Because the truth is, every single one of us is created in the image of God for the purpose of relationship. And every single one of us falls short of that. It's called sin. One way or another, we've all broken God's commands. And so all alike stand in need of the redeeming power of Jesus Christ. So what this church stands for is proclaiming Jesus Christ is the truth and Jesus Christ is the power to transform. You are more than welcome to come here and join the rest of us as we embrace Him as the power to change, to transform. This whole story about cribiazin, that fake cancer drug a few years ago that was all the rage. I think it struck a chord because 3 years ago, my wife was going through cancer treatment. And I will tell you something, that focuses your mind. And you want to know, what is the truth? What do I have? What am I dealing with? And how do I get treated for that? And then having gone through chemotherapy and radiation and all that stuff, what you want to know is, what is the powerful thing that can bring me back to health? We want to know truth. We want to understand power. The very same time Vicky was going through all of that, another woman, friend of ours, was going through it also. And as Vicky got better and got stronger, she fell sicker and sicker. Ultimately, she lost her life. She died. But that wasn't a loss. Where there is a failure of science and medicine and technology, Jesus Christ welcomed her into eternal glory. Only God does that. Only God, out of that deep hurt and loss, can bring the promise and the hope of heaven and restoration and help to those who remain. You look for the power to transform. You want to live a life that is not filled with fear about the world in which we live. The truth is found in Jesus Christ. The power to change is found in Jesus Christ. Christian, live that out. Live it out this week. I want to pray for you. Father, I pray for those here who feel a deep fear or a distrust of our world and the powers that be. They have been, or they feel like they have been, mistreated and done wrong. God, I pray that they would discover the truth that Jesus Christ is the one who transforms. That the power to live above our circumstances, to live beyond fear, to be welcomed into the family of God is the power found through faith in Jesus Christ. And Father, I pray they would recognize that Jesus Christ is the God in a man, God in body, that He bore the sins of the world, including theirs, that He died and He rose again. And if they believe that, they are made right. They are welcomed into the family of God. Father, I pray for those of us who trust Jesus. It's easy for us to buy the latest book or think this is the technique that will work. God, I pray that we would find our identity. We would begin with our faith in Jesus Christ. That our first response would be to turn to You in prayer. To learn more deeply about Jesus and what He means for transformation in our lives. And Father, I pray we would, as Jesus does, come alongside those who bear the heaviest burdens to be an encouragement and a help to them. And Father, that we might discover and we might even model the truth of Jesus and the power of Jesus. Thank You that that's not secret. That's an open truth. And thank You for transforming. And we ask this in Jesus' name. And all God's people agreed by saying,